welcome once again to Building a Decent Future. The late black historian Carter G. Woodson, Dr. Carter G. Woodson, wrote that if a race has no recorded history, its achievements will be forgotten or overlooked and finally claimed by other groups. Such a race becomes a negligible factor in the thought of the world and stands in danger of being exterminated. Whether or not you agree with that thought, I think it's obvious to most that black history in America, and in Buffalo in particular, has been somewhat overlooked or forgotten, strayed, and not compiled as history should be recorded. Our distinguished guests today are two individuals that are involved in that sometimes thankless task. Professor Monroe Fordham of Buffalo State's History Department, Buffalo State College's History Department, is a nationally published author who has taken on the task of compiling Buffalo's black history and has written a couple of articles that pertain to that, and we'll talk to him about the aspects of that program. Mr. Leland Jones, Jr. is quite a history maker himself. He's a lifelong resident of Buffalo and has gained notable distinction in areas of education, youth activities, athletics, civil rights, and government, and has served as a county legislator in the 5th District, 5th Ward, and was the first black elected city councilman representing the Ellicott District. He's with us today as president of the Black History Foundation. Gentlemen, welcome to Building a Decent Future.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Jones, why don't you tell us a little bit about the Black History Foundation, this being the final day, I guess, of Black History Week.
This is it, and we've had quite a week with the mayor signing our proclamation. And then last night, as you know, we had our very big affair, as we have had every year for the last 20 years under Mrs. Joyce Allen. Last night, we took on the responsibility of presenting to the people I've known Rivers and Celeste Tisdale of Erie Community College in the English department there. Was the consultant, and he handled the direction of the entire program. Over the last 20 years, the organization has had different names, but always the same person and all same purpose, and always under Mrs. Joyce Allen, who has worked so diligently to bring to the attention of the people of Buffalo the fact that we do have a history, such as Carter Woodson says, that deserves putting down on paper or in some way letting the people know about.
Great. Brother Fordham, why don't you tell us about your efforts at compiling history and the background behind it?
Okay, well, most of our efforts have been in the area of local history. We're interested, we recognize that in writing history, you have to start with resources, you have to start with primary materials. And we're interested in putting together or identifying, locating, and preserving the kind of sources from which that history is going to be written in the future. And we're interested in collecting individual as well as organization records. We index, organize, and microfilm those records and then give them back to the individuals from which they came. And once these records are organized, indexed, and microfilmed, they're then placed in the Buffalo Afro-American Historical Collection, which is located at the North Jefferson Branch Library, and there's also a copy of it, the microfilm copy of it, which is located at the archives at the Buffalo State College.
Okay, now you say you're compiling Buffalo history, and I just want to reemphasize that you're also appealing to those in our viewing audience that may have some historical data that may never reach the books anywhere,
sure,
that they can add this to your collection without actually giving it up. Why don't you explain a little bit more about how you're preserving?
Sure. Well, as I said, all history is written primarily from records of some sort, and we're trying to identify those records that are presently available and in existence in our community. For instance, organizations that go back into the 20s and 30s, they may have complete records, minutes, and all kinds of documents relating to their efforts in Buffalo. Individuals, political figures, people who've been active in the community, they may have correspondence, they may have file cabinets full of things that they've kept. So if they will contact us through the North Jefferson Branch Library, we will survey what they have, we will organize it for them, we will we will compile a detailed index of that, and then we will microfilm those records for them, and then we will give those records back to them. Plus, we will give them a copy of the microfilm. This is an advantage to organizations and individuals, because if they somehow happen to lose their records or want to, you know, if the records are no longer usable, then they have a microfilm copy, plus they have the knowledge of knowing that those records are in two local libraries. And we're going to encourage research and generate scholarship from that material.
How will you catalog these things? How will you index them?
Well, we...
microfilm.
Yes, we have a very detailed index. For instance, we organize it, let's say, according to correspondence. We have, let's say, if we're dealing with an individual, we have correspondence received over, say, a 30-year period. We organize that chronologically.
Mm-hmm.
And then correspondence sent. We organize it all chronologically. Then in the index to the microfilm, we list each letter, the date, who it was to, who it was from, something to identify the contents of that letter, so that if there will be a long index that precedes the microfilm, so that it'll make retrieval very easy for somebody.
Yeah. Suppose we had a student working for an advanced degree,
mm-hmm.
and he wanted information along a certain categorical line.
Mm-hmm.
Would he use the Library of Congress type thing, or the Dewey Decimal System, or how would he find what he's after, other than the retrieval system such as you're talking about that's in-house?
Okay. Well, the name of the collection, once we put it in the North Jefferson Branch Library and the Buffalo State Archives, it is listed in the regular archives report.
Mm-hmm, I see.
So the name of the collection would be listed all over the country, wherever there are archives.
Mm-hmm.
And if anyone is interested, say, in economic organizations in Buffalo, they would consult with that index, and they would indicate that the North Jefferson Branch Library in Buffalo has a collection on that. Now, to get the detail index itself, you know, they could either write for that, or if they were local people, they could simply go over to the North Jefferson Branch Library, consult with the index, and they would be able to find out, without going to the microfilm itself, whether that microfilm had anything in it that they wanted to use.
I think that you and I have a chance to work together on something here, because we've got the people who can reach out, have their tentacles reaching out into the community.
That's right.
But do not have an archive set up, so to speak.
Well, that's beautiful. That's one of the aspects I was glad that you both gentlemen could meet here under these circumstances to coordinate a lot of your efforts. Why don't you go ahead and continue?
We're
going to
give the Black Development Foundation credit for pulling this together then.
That's right, right there.
We have had some people in the past that have taken it upon themselves to be Buffalo's local historians.
Right.
For instance, there was Clarence Maloney, an attorney. His wife, the Cora Maloney, you know about. But Clarence gathered information, and he probably knew more about Black Buffalo than any man that I've known. Then, of course, one person you can't forget is Frank Merriweather.
Right, I don't know Mr. Merriweather on the show.
Frank has just piles and piles of
Black history in Buffalo.
The Reverend Nash, who's passed, Jesse Nash's father, had a whole basement loaded with information about Buffalo since the since the slavery days.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the kind of information I'm sure you're after.
Yeah,
and
what have you compiled so far, just to give us an idea of what you have?
Well, we've done about 9 collections. One of the things that we've done that I think maybe the Buffalo
Black Development
Foundation might be interested in, the BDF came into existence in the late 60s, is that right?
Right.
Well, at about that time, an organization which was founded back during the mid-20s, an offshoot of the Garvey movement in part and influenced by the thinking of Booker T. Washington, the Buffalo Cooperative Economic Society was probably trying to do essentially what the BDF is trying to do right now, but yet those two groups never touched base. Now, for about 30 years, this organization, the Buffalo Cooperative Economic Society, struggled in Buffalo trying to do what, you know, that organization is trying to do now. Now, the interesting part of it is that organization, the Cooperative Economic Society, kept all of their records. They had detailed records, all of their minutes. They had over 10,000 pages of documents, mm-hmm. which has been microfilmed, and now it is in the North Jefferson Branch Library. So this is the kind of thing that maybe the BDF could have put somebody on that to research and examine their records and to go back and see where their highs and lows were and what some of the problems they encountered, because many of the people in that organization have now passed on. But the point is, their records are still in existence. Some of the members are still...
Can you recall who some of these people were? This is...
One of the founders and the president for many years was a doctor.
Dr. Scruggs?
I can't think of his name right offhand.
But it was a local physician that practiced in Buffalo area.
Yeah, Dr. Nelson.
Dr. E.
Nelson. And then I've worked with that collection so long, I don't know how I could forget that. But
let's talk about the aspect of, you say it's being housed, the collection that you have now, mm-hmm. in the North Jefferson Branch Library.
Yes.
Do you foresee this expanding to a degree where you need like a black building for historical purposes?
Well, ideally, one of the things about this kind of work is that in the financial area, it cannot support itself. So it almost always has to be housed in a public facility that is already being financed and funded. Or there has to be some kind of economic hookup, fundraising drives, and that sort of thing. And that is usually cumbersome and is not the kind of thing that can give permanency, which an organization of this sort needs.
Really needs,
so
right.
We will probably maintain our association in some public facility.
We've been thinking about that. Our trustees have. It's come up on different meetings. The trouble is that the Buffalo community is spread so that it's not an easy thing to have one location that's usable by all of the black community, or even the white community that wants to make use of black history.
Right.
The Lackawanna community and the Niagara Falls communities are two prime examples, but then we've got people now that are no longer living in clumps, but are scattered all over the Western New York area.
Right.
How then can we expect them to come to one central location? Isn't there some way that we can make arrangements to move the materials to them, such as the County of Erie's bookmobile sort of thing? But the beautiful part about what you're doing and is having things that people can go to for research.
Yes.
We admit ours is a showcase sort of thing. We want to bring it out and let the people come in and take a look at it almost as though it were a museum type thing,
right,
and
right,
not a research library type work. I hope that the two can get together, because then we might be able to find a building or something else where we can get to some grants and perhaps some insurance to cover the documents that you've got, but it's worth looking into.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that. The basic differences between the thrust of our two groups, your group is interested in bringing national and international black history to this whole area, whites and blacks and whoever. Our primary focus is on providing a research center whereby this historical tradition can be continually researched and continued. And of course, we invite everybody from the community, you know, scholars, UB, State College, everybody who's interested in this topic to work out of that facility. But it'll be a central location where, you know, if you're interested in something on local black history, you can go there and find it fairly easy.
Why don't we mention the number and address of the your Afro-American History Association at the North Jefferson Library, and how people can make input to the work that you're doing?
Okay, if anyone has records and documents, either personal or business or institution, and would like to have these records microfilmed, organized, indexed, and microfilmed, and put in the North Jefferson Branch collection, you simply call the North Jefferson Branch Library, and their number is 883-4418. and Melvin Watkins, who is the head librarian there, or some of his staff can give you information on how we'll, you know, go about doing this, and then I'll simply contact you, and we'll start the.
Okay, great. We'll try to repeat that number
process
before the program is over. Mr. Jones, as far as the bicentennial year, what plans are in progress for furthering the Black History Foundation?
Well, through Mrs. Joyce Allen, who's our executive director, we plan to have an association, or to contact every organization interested in Black history, to have them as adjunct members of the organization, so that we can have an opportunity to reach out to all parts of the area for information. We intend to ask people to not necessarily keep diaries, as we talked about earlier, but to actually write up certain experiences at one particular time in the year. For instance, this week we're talking about Negro history per se, and we had our I've Known the Rivers presentation. But suppose in a couple of months we say this is going to be the week when we're asking everybody to send in an anecdote, or to send in something that they know that's happened. We can relate it to Buffalo this year, and have them bring, let us know what they've had happen in their past, with their families, with their friends, with Black people who have made contributions. And then when we get this in, go over to you and say, all right, here's some information documented.
That's great.
Yeah, I think that's very important, because many of the people in our community now who are reaching the age of retirement, who may be interested in writing family histories in their leisure time, or writing the history of organizations in which they've been a member. Now that, you know, we have these facilities set up, if they want to have that information preserved forever so that it can be used for research purposes, it'll be primary material from which history can be written.
Mm-hmm.
We will certainly make sure that that information is preserved and cataloged in the library, and cataloged in the national and international archival, you know, retrieval indexes.
There's one other thing I might add to that. All too often when we think about Black history, or start to talk about it, we talk about individuals and not events.
Right.
And we're in hope that we can get people to let us know some of the things that have happened in terms of periods of time.
Mm-hmm.
This, I think, will be of great assistance to you, too.
Right, as far as this, like, this is the type of event that you put on with the Black History Foundation. This was a question I was going to ask. How can this type of thing be recorded? Say, if it's a videotaped event, an event that was videotaped or filmed, can this be microfilmed also?
Well, in that instance, the videotape and the microfilm will be, or the actual tape will be preserved. One of the problems are technologically, it's a technological problem with archives. Magnetic tape, the stuff that's on it, after a period of 20 years or so, it moves around.
Right.
So what we'll probably end up doing is, if we can get speeches and the tape records, we'll probably end up putting
make
that in type,
now,
making a type of that, you know, typing that out
that's
in terms of an interview, because that's the only way it can be preserved over 200 or 300 years, you know, because the tape itself, the magnetic quality is such that it can't be preserved for over 2 or 3 decades.
There's one other thing I want to bring to your attention, and that is the collection of arts. People that are writing poems, writing songs, things of this nature.
Right.
And dancing. Then oral contributions, too. You know, we as Black people all over the centuries have been very good at passing stories along one generation to the other without putting it down on something.
Right.
And even though your magnetic tape may not keep it too long, even that is a contribution.
Sure, we can.
Just putting it in word by word of mouth.
That's
sure, we can take that tape and, you know, put it in type.
Mm-hmm.
See, hopefully, this is maybe a way that our two organizations could work together, because basically we're not at the present time you know, attempting to generate a fundraising campaign. But if your organization may want to take on as one of their projects to finance the, you know, the transforming of tape programs into type so that it can be preserved on paper, you know.
I see. The dancing now, that, how would you do something like that?
Well,
that
of course, if film, you know, if the event is filmed, mm-hmm. not on videotape, but
right.
if it's just...
Film can be preserved.
Yeah, film can be preserved. That's the same as microfilm.
Yes.
Microfilm can be preserved 300 years.
Right.
Well, maybe this can lead into preserving the actual events that the foundation puts on.
Mm-hmm.
Plus your programs like the one from last night. You know, this is a document in and of itself.
Very good. That's a point. That's
yeah,
a very
can,
good point.
If we can collect, say, from people in Buffalo, all the printed programs that they have in their possession, and then we can have a program index.
Mm-hmm.
we make a program index.
Well, I'm sure there's a lot of, I can think of a couple, including the Black Drama Workshop, which
sure.
I was associated with, that has programs from plays,
sure.
and scripts from plays.
Mary Chappelle on our board, I'm sure everybody in the listening
right.
audience who's in the Black community knows her, has a tremendous collection of information. I'm going to ask her to get in touch with you,
sure.
too, so that we can start
right.
letting people know they can share this wealth.
Very definitely.
This has very much been in the neglect in the last few years. What about in your research on Black history in Buffalo, have you've checked, I'm sure, with the Historical Society about that type of information that they have compiled, and or have you?
Well, yes. Usually, Historical Societies, partly because of the way they're funded, don't have an outstanding track record in terms of collecting the records and documents from...
You are very nice. Why don't you just come out and tell it? They've just plain been too prejudiced to go ahead and put the stuff down and let people know that we've got a history. That's what the story is.
It hasn't been totally recorded.
I'm awfully pleased to say that right now at City Campus of Erie Community College, they've begun to really set aside time and effort and parts of money from the libraries to gather some information and data. Now, this is new.
Oh, yeah, I think we're going to have to take the initiative in our own community in doing that. However, I should point out that this information, once it's collected, will be available to anybody in the community. But I think we're going to have to take the initiative ourselves in making sure that it's done. Because I think, as Richardson says, if we don't do it,
we'll be ours after a while.
That's right.
Right. Well, how about events that you do have planned or that you're thinking of as far as the bicentennial?
As far as the bicentennial is concerned, the emphasis has not been very strong on the efforts of the year itself. And I'm a little disappointed about that, too. I hate to see an important year like this go by and have Black people feel that just because we haven't benefited as we know we ought to have over the last 200 years, that all these millions and millions of dollars that are being spent, all this set up for the collection of information is ignored simply because we're saying, well, we don't want to participate, they didn't do anything for us. I think it's our time now to step out and try to reverse the trend, and in the next 200 years, make sure that we won't have to look back askance at ourselves.
Yeah, I think that's very true. We have to take advantage of the time, the interest, the public interest is there for history, and we have to take advantage of the situation and try to do what we can to put our history in perspective.
So in the next meeting, we will be discussing this after we take care of our ordinary business, because we've got still got money to collect to take care of the bills for this last affair, but after that, we're going to start turning our attention to the bicentennial and what can be done to get the most out of it.
Okay, what about viewers that might want to add some input financially or, you know, physically by helping volunteer?
There's one person that I wish you'd make note of, those of you who are watching this program, or you can pass the information on, and that is how to get in touch with Mrs. Joyce Allen. She's at 506 East Ferry, 886-1263. Mrs. Allen is our executive director, as I said, and she will make sure that we can get information to you on how you can make contributions to the foundation to make sure that we're prepared for these programs we want to put on.
Okay, how about in your program, Professor Fordham, about students that might be involved in history programs? Can they get historical projects to work on from you for
the Sure, we'll, very definitely. They could send, there are already a number of students from the University of Buffalo who are already beginning to use the collection over at the North Jefferson Branch Library. This Saturday, I think it's the 21st, Mrs. Hortense Nash and some of the colored women's organizations of Buffalo is going to sponsor a program over to North Jefferson. Anyone interested in learning more about the kind of work that our organization is doing at North Jefferson, this would be a perfect time for you to go over there, and you could peruse around the library and get a look at some of the collections that we do have. Right. And if you're interested in that particular program, it's on Saturday, February 21st, and you can call the North Jefferson Branch Library and they can give you more information on it.
Okay, now you speak periodically on Black history programs at the library. Is that a regular?
Well, they have, the North Jefferson again, has a regular history class that meets every Thursday night, I believe. It's under the direction of Miss Sharon Jordan. They have a regular program, but in addition, they have occasional speakers from around the city and even from out of town talking on various topics of Black history. So if you're interested in that Black history class, which meets regularly, you can contact the North Jefferson again.
Okay, great. Are there any aspects of your program that we haven't covered as far as what citizen input there is can be made?
Well, I would just urge people who have records and documents of any kind, we are very much interested in preserving those. If you have the records, we'll organize it, index it, microfilm it, give a copy back to you of the microfilm, give you your original records back, and then we'll catalog it and preserve the materials in the North Jefferson Branch Library and the Buffalo State Archives.
Okay, we have about a minute left. I'd like to thank Mr. Leland Jones from the Black History Foundation, Professor Monroe Fordham from Buffalo State, and the Afro-American Association for History in Buffalo. And just to remind you of those numbers again, the North Jefferson Branch Library number, 883-4418, and Mrs. Joyce Allen of the Buffalo Black History Foundation's number is 886-1263. We hope you've enjoyed today's program, and we hope we'll be hearing from the input that you put into Black history in Buffalo. And again, I'd like to thank you, gentlemen, for being with us on Building a Decent Future.
Thank you.
See you next week.